Please stand for the presentation of colors by the Greensboro Fire Department Honor Guard, and please remain standing for the singing of our national anthem performed by Fire Engineer Robert Johnson.
Say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say doth that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the
You may be seated. I would like to take this opportunity to recognize members from our City Council, Mr. Westmoreland, and others from members of the City Manager's Office, along with Chief Graces and the executive team. Thank you for being here today for the graduation ceremony of the 66 recruit class of the Greensboro Fire Department. At this time, we'd like to recognize some very, very special folks that I'm sure are glad that these 21 weeks are over. To you, it's probably felt more like 42 weeks. And as members of these gentlemen's family, you've endured a lot these past few months, and we'd like to recognize you. So if you are family of one of these that's graduating today, we ask you to stand so we can say thank you for your assistance as well. The next group I'd like to recognize is these gentlemen to my left. Gentlemen, please stand. This is the training staff of the Greensboro Fire Department. It's one thing to be a part of this great department. For those that don't know, the Greensboro Fire Department was the first fire department in the United States to be recognized as a Class 1 internationally accredited department. To train people in this department says a lot about who they are. And I want to thank them. They are second to none in this country for their passion and what it means to train firefighters here in Greensboro. Now, I'd like to especially recognize Captain Hall and Captain Jones. These gentlemen are the primary instructors. And again, their passion goes far beyond what they did with these gentlemen. So thank you for your service and what you've done these past 21 weeks. Thank you. And then there are the guys who help perform pressure every morning at 7 o'clock. Whipped them in shape, got them in great physical condition. And some of them, due to being on duty, are not here, but I'd like to recognize Captain Oakley, Captain Kennedy, Fire Engineer Kenny Robertson, and always dedicated retired firefighter Jesse Walker. He's a true living Energizer Bunny. He just keeps on ticking. I'd like to also recognize a member of the police department's training staff. What a joy it is to be in the same building with these individuals. So, Captain Allen, we thank you and your staff for being here and attending this morning. There's someone that's not with us today. Wanda Wyatt went to the training center when it opened in 2003 as the administrative assistant. And she was with us when this class began. Wanda succumbed to cancer on July 4th. And I can't think of a better day for her to go to heaven, because as we were celebrating fireworks here, I'm sure they were celebrating there also, because she was one wonderful lady who took care of both fire and police at the training center, and she will be missed. But Wanda, we know you're looking down this morning watching, so thank you, and we do miss you. Now, these next few comments I'm directing straight to the 66 recruit class. I'm going to be quoting a verse from 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7. It's pretty common. Paul was on his final missionary journey, and he was writing to Timothy. And I quote, "I have fought a good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith." Well, gentlemen, I don't think that applies to you. You have fought a good fight. You were among 700 people who applied. We whittled it down and whittled it down and whittled it down, and you became part of the 66 recruit class. You have endured a lot. I think you'll have fond memories of the first day with Captain Hall and Captain Jones getting acclimatized to the training facility. I think the tour you took turned out to be not much of a tour at all. But you've endured. You have gone through many tests. You have completed a lot of physical activity, a lot of training drills, and you fought a good fight. You finished the race. That's why you're here today. You're getting ready to come up here and receive a badge pinned on your chest by a loved one. You stayed the course. You finished the race. And we hope that you're here with us for 30 years. But if you choose to go in a different direction, no one can ever take away from you the fact that you completed 21 weeks and earned the title of Greensboro Firefighter. The last part of this verse, "I have kept the faith." That's yet to be seen. That's getting ready to begin. You're getting ready to go out on that fire truck. You're getting ready to respond to calls. Will you remain faithful when it comes to checking your truck in the morning? Will you remain faithful when it comes to checking that air pack? How about staying in shape, training, studying? In 1883, the United States Marine Corps adopted a Latin phrase as our motto. The phrase is Semper Fidelis. In English, it means always faithful. Not when it's convenient, not when you want to, not even when it feels good, but always faithful. So I challenge you to also adopt that motto for yourself, because there's 277,000 citizens out there that are counting on you to be faithful every time that beeper hits. So with that said, congratulations on a job well done, and Godspeed to each of you in your career with the Greensboro Fire Department. At this time, I would like to recognize Mr. Jim Westmoreland, City Manager of the City of Greensboro.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you, Chief Nix, for that introduction. Chief Nix has said a lot already that I was going to say this morning, so I'm going to talk about a couple of things that are important to me and the city team. First of all, I did want to extend my congratulations, thanks, and appreciation to the members of the class here, 17 strong. They started out with 20 individuals. They're down now to 17. It says a lot to me and to us about the character of these recruits and what they have been through for the past 21 weeks now to make it to the finish line, like the chief said. I had an opportunity to spend a few minutes with them about 2 weeks ago as they were sort of winding down their training and their routine with the training process here in Greensboro. And one thing that really struck me was, again, how excited, how energized, how motivated each one of them were to serve this community. I think as city employees, what you're about to step into today is a family of 3,100 employees that serve the citizens of Greensboro each and every day. Whether you know it or not, what you do each and every day is extremely important, not only to this community, but as the chief mentioned, to your families as well. We can't thank the families enough, quite frankly, for what you've done to support these recruits to this point, but we will tell you that your journey is just beginning with their journey. As they step into the shoes of a Greensboro firefighter today, into the shoes of a Greensboro city employee, they're going to need you more than ever. They're going to need you there to help support them through the good times and through the tough times. They have done a lot of good work to get to this point in terms of their training, and they will effectively have to use that training each and every day. The chief mentioned about the importance of the department. Certainly I can tell you that I see it each and every day in the job that I do as city manager for Greensboro. Had an opportunity to make it home at about 6 o'clock. I think it was Wednesday night. We had a line of thunderstorms that rolled through the community. A lot of rain, a lot of thunder, a lot of lightning, and then a lot of sirens. And as I was sitting there in my living room watching TV, the nightly news, I heard the sirens get closer and closer, and sure enough, when I looked out the window, there was engine number 2 going by my front door. And it just reinforced to me the importance of the job that each one of you are just about to take on for the city. And a couple of different things. First of all, from the perspective of the training that you've received and being ready to respond to the calls when they come. Second of all, from the perspective that you're not going to be asked to get into ideal conditions with every call. You're going to have situations that you are asked to walk into quite literally from time to time, run into that won't be safe and won't be secure. But I'm confident, we're confident in your abilities and your training through the department to be able to do an excellent job like the department has in the past and respond to the call when it's needed. The other thing that I would add is, like the chief mentioned, you're getting ready to join what I would consider to be the finest fire department in the whole country. Certainly, we are privileged and blessed here in this city to have a very supportive city council, and we do have a couple of members with us this morning. It's hard to see out into the audience, but I know that at least Council Member Abuzawaiter, Council Member Hoffman are here. What I'd like to do is just to ask them to stand up and be recognized, and if there's other members of council that I didn't see, if you would stand up, let's give them a round of applause this morning. When I accepted the role to be city manager in February the 1st of this year, I knew that this city council and our previous city councils had been very supportive of public safety and public safety efforts for Greensboro. But I can tell you that is reinforced to me and to the city team every day by them directly. It's reinforced by them being here this morning. We all know that public safety is the most important thing that we can do and we can provide for this community. We are blessed to have you all join a public safety team, not only of the fire department, but also of the police department, Guilford Metro 911 Communications, our county service providers. And it really is a team effort when you think about how we deploy resources in the jobs that you're asked to do. So let me end by saying this. First of all, thank you again to each one of you for taking and stepping up to the call to become a Greensboro firefighter, joining what, again, I consider to be the finest firefighting department in the whole country. Second of all, thanks to your families. Make sure, and I will be, quite frankly, a little emotional. I get emotional every time that I attend one of these ceremonies, whether it's for the fire department or the police department. And part of it has to do with the fact that I lost my father last year. So every time that I see a father and a son or a family connect on the stage, it means a lot to me. So my point is this. Cherish every moment, both as individuals that are graduating today and the family members. You never know when something's going to happen. This job is predictable, but it's also very unpredictable. We saw that again last year when the episode that happened in the city. Hug each other often. Tell each other that you love each other often. And understand that at the end of the day, you need to keep perspective and focus on your family and what that means to you. So with that, thank you again for letting me share a few remarks on behalf of the city team, on behalf of the city council. We're glad to have you in the family. Look forward to supporting you in any way that we can to be successful in your roles. And again, as the chief said, Godspeed to you. And thank you again for having me.
Thank you, Mr. Westmoreland. At this time, I'd like to introduce Chief Fire Grayson, Fire Chief for the City of Greensboro Fire Department.
Good morning. Good morning. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you for making this a priority in your day to be here. Thank you for being here to support your loved ones and folks that you care about. This is an important day in the history of our department, and we're very appreciative of you being a part of that. Edward Crocker in 1908 said, "When a person becomes a firefighter, their greatest act of bravery has been accomplished. What they do after that is all in the line of duty." So from 1908 to today, the same thing can be said. When a person becomes a firefighter, their greatest act of bravery has been accomplished. We're here today to celebrate the accomplishments of our recruit class, the accomplishments of their hard work, training, and dedication. We're here to thank our family members that are with us and loved ones. We're here to give appreciation for our elected officials and community leaders that are here. When you come in today, we were blessed to have some honor guard and also be able to see some of the things that are so important to the fire service. Can you feel some pride in the room this morning? Can you feel some of that pride? When you listen to the music, when you see the importance people place on this event today, I hope that you leave feeling that pride and able to take that with you. Chief Nix talked about our instructors this morning for the program, so very important to making this a success. The impact that these instructors have had on these gentlemen would be something they carry with them the rest of their life, and my appreciation to all the instructors that have been a part of this program. To the graduates, today's your day, and we're here to celebrate your accomplishment. The fire service and the fire department, we exist to serve people. The reason we're here is to serve. We're here to serve people. That's why we exist as an organization. And wherever you go in the state or wherever you go in the country, there's a common tie that binds firefighters. Many people will call that that is a calling. It's a calling to be a firefighter. It's not an easy job. It's not a safe job, but it is a rewarding job and one that ties us together with people we've never even met, but we know if that person's a firefighter, other firefighters relate, connect, and it's a tie that binds. Our mission is rather simple, to protect life and property. That's what our mission of the fire department is, protecting life and property. Though it sounds simple, delivering that is very complex, particularly in all the levels of services we provide today. Some people will say, well, there's fewer fires than there were 30, 40 years ago. In numbers, that may be true. The intensity and danger of those fires we have today is far more. My father was a firefighter. The fires that he dealt with many years ago, very different than the ones that our men and women deal with today. Much more plastics in homes, much more heat, much more different construction. All those things together make it a much more dangerous environment. So it's a complex system. Our department and can be judged in many ways. We have lots of measures. Chief Nix talked about that. We talked about accreditation. We talked about the insurance industry rating. We talked about reviews and standards, all the different ways we can be judged. And we're a very regulated industry, if you will. But regardless of all kinds of ratings or measures, the real test comes when Mrs. Smith dials 911 and she needs help. And she wants someone to come quickly, someone who's trained, prepared, and who can carry out the duties and do it in an expedient manner. And so that's really the test that we face. Regardless of any credentials, are we able to perform when the call is made? And if we are, then we establish the most important and most treasured thing that we can have as an entity, a governmental entity, as a fire department, and that is public trust. And the importance of public trust. I talked to our recruits about that yesterday and emphasized the importance and how valuable public trust is and also how fragile it is and how important it is to our success. As family members, you have supported your loved ones through this whole process. I know that you have to be thinking about this is a very valuable career, very rewarding career. But you have to be thinking in your head, well, this is also a very dangerous career, and it is. Our men and women daily go into what is called IDLH environments. That's a government term for immediately dangerous to life and health. We had a stark reminder of that on January 30th. Mr. Westmoreland alluded to it a few minutes ago, just a few blocks over from here on Elm Street. We have those credentials that Chief Nix talked about, accredited Class 1. We do a lot of work with training, preparedness, planning. We're a strong fire department. We're a good fire department. In any event, though, we go into bad situations and dangerous situations. And we had a stark reminder on January 30th, such a close call for us. We were so very blessed that many things went right that day. Many things worked as it should. Yes, there's things we're learning, things that we need to modify, change. We were continuously working on that. But things did go well that day. And the thing that I continue to come back to, I heard from so many of our people, was we had just gone through an intensive training exercise on our training ground with entrapment and Mayday. And had just gone through that with most all the department. We were preparing for new air packs. I heard from so many people who were involved that day how valuable that training was and how it made a difference. So training has a direct line to success of our department. But it was a stark reminder of how dangerous this profession is and how any call that comes along. On that particular day, it was about a noon 12:30 hour, and it was a call like so many others. And everything changed with three words: Mayday, Mayday, Mayday. When those words were given, everything changed. But I'd say to your families, yes, this is a dangerous profession. However, our department's very committed to training. We're committed to continuous improvement. We're committed to safety. And so there were a lot of things that went right that afternoon. And fortunately, all of our firefighters survived that incident. And we're learning from it, and we're becoming better because of it. Our city had invested in training, we had invested in equipment, we had invested in preparing, and we were very blessed that day. But it helps us to ask the question, are we prepared? These gentlemen before you today are showing that they're prepared and our department is prepared. They are our future. These recruits are our department's future. And thank you so much to the instructors, to the family members for investing in our future and helping prepare them. To be a firefighter, these gentlemen have to have a heart that cares. They have to want to make a positive difference. They go into situations when others come out. You may get that image in your mind from September 11, 2001. One of the most famous photographs taken that day was New York City firefighters coming up the stairs while everyone else was coming down. That's not 9/11 2001. That's every day. That's not New York. That's Greensboro. Our men and women go in when others come out. It's said that success is opportunity meeting preparedness, and we certainly have a lot of opportunities to serve and protect people. And that our department is certainly comprised of successful firefighters, because if our firefighters are successful, our department is successful. I spoke with the recruits yesterday on some key priorities. Number one, take care of yourself, take care of the people that we serve, safety and the importance of that. Number two, courtesy, always treat people with dignity and respect. We see people in the worst days of their life, so always remember that, treat them with dignity and courtesy and respect. They will remember how they're treated much more so than their technical skill you have. Number three, provide excellent service. Look for ways to do the very best you can to serve and protect people. Go above and beyond at every opportunity. Remember, we always work with tax dollars and the public money, and we have a responsibility to be good stewards of that money. And last, always work to achieve and improve, continuous improvement. So safety, courtesy, excellent service, efficiency, and continuous improvement. And I encourage them to follow those priorities. We're all very proud of this class. They already have succeeded in so many ways. We want them to continue to succeed. And to the entire group, loved ones, family, please help us in creating an environment for them to continue to succeed. They'll need to continue to have support. They'll have good days, they'll have tough days, there's going to be birthdays they miss, holidays, family events. As I said earlier, this job is more of a calling, something someone has to be very personally committed to. So we ask you to continue to support them as they move forward. These firefighters do have the basics. They have a good foundation. Our training staff's done an excellent job. They have the foundation. The ball is in their court now moving forward. And what they do with that, how they move forward, will be choices that they make. Let me share with you in closing today a poem by Robert Athens, and he's from the fire department in New York City. Let me share this with you, and as you think about your recruit, think about this a little bit today. So as you look at the firefighter with his rake, hose, or axe, his beet-red face or ice-covered mustache, you should know why he goes through that smoky front door and is forced to crawl like a baby down the floor. He does it to save both lives and property, all that is precious to you and me. So take a look at this modern warrior who serves his call proud and true, and know that he would die just to save me and you. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give a hand to our modern warriors and our recruit class. I have been asked to recognize one individual from this recruit class that is the recipient of the Chief's Award for this particular class. And let me share with you, if I may, a little bit about the person and their achievement. Again, this has been a 21-week program thus far. Some will continue through training a little bit longer, but thus far, 21 weeks. Chief Nix talked about how we've moved from 700 people down to 17 at this point. One individual, though, deserves recognition here today, and I'd like to call him forward, if I may. Chris Braddock, would you please step forward? Chris has an overall academic average of 94.28, and that places him in the top of the class, and he has earned the distinction of receiving the Chief's Award.
Good morning. Congratulations, 66 recruit class. You've all come a long way since day one, April 1st. And I know some of you were probably thinking that first day, this was one of the cruelest April Fool's jokes that's ever been played on you that Tuesday morning. And you know what? I thought the same thing. When I saw you run from the gun range to the drill tower, I thought, maybe they're playing a joke on me. Because some of these guys, I don't know if they're going to make it. My thoughts going through my mind was, I'm looking at some of these guys, and they can't even get up the steps without holding on. Are they going to make this 21 weeks? But I sit here and I look at every one of you this morning, and you have proven to me that you're worthy to be a Greensboro firefighter. Each of you have worked extremely hard academically, physically, and mentally through the summer heat and humidity, and you've kept your composure during some of the most intense physical training you've probably ever been a part of. Every one of you have accomplished something, and nothing was given to you. Nothing was given to any one of you, and you've proven that you're worthy of this, and I can stand here today and say that each one of you have earned this diploma that you'll receive this morning. Now, we do have some individual awards that we'd like to present, but I want each of you to know that we as a training staff are extremely proud of each of you, and we have full confidence that you're prepared and ready to represent the Greensboro Fire Department. What I'd like to do now, as I said, we do have some individual awards, and the first award that we want to present is the Training Staff Award. And I'll just read the description of that Training Staff Award. The officers and firefighters of the Greensboro Fire Department would like to congratulate you for your level of achievement over the past 21 weeks of training. Your overall level of practical skills and academic performance identifies you as an outstanding member and leader of the 66 recruit class. The Training Staff Award is given in recognition of overall performance during a recruit training class. The recipient is selected by the training staff on the basis of outstanding leadership skills, academic standing, and practical evolution performance. After reviewing evaluations throughout the class, your accomplishments are of no surprise. The training staff is pleased to inform you that you've been selected as the recipient of the 66 Recruit Class Training Staff Award. Please accept our best wishes for your continued success and achievement in the Greensboro Fire Department. And this award goes to Firefighter Travis Carter. Our next award is probably one of the most prestigious awards that will be presented today. And the reason for that is we didn't have a vote in this award. The award was voted on by the members of the 66 recruit class. And what they voted on was someone who was that informal leader, someone they could go to for some advice and wisdom in the locker room behind closed doors. And I'll read this award. This award recognizes your abilities during the Recruit Academy to provide informal leadership to your classmates. It's a true honor to receive this recognition from your peers and speaks volumes to your integrity and work ethic. On behalf of the training staff and your fellow members of the 66 recruit class, we'd like to congratulate you as the recipient of the Recruit Achievement Award. Please accept our best wishes for your continued success and achievement in the Greensboro Fire Department. And this award goes to Firefighter Christopher Holmes. Our last individual award we want to present this morning is for the Firefighters Ability Test Award. This award was something that each one of these guys would work for. Each one of these guys, every other Tuesday, would have to run through the Firefighters Ability Test course, and I know that each of them dreaded it. Every Tuesday morning they came in, you could just see they were just sick. And then when it was over, oh, you're talking about relief. It was like a weight was lifted off of their shoulders. But we took all of the times and averaged all the times, and this award will be presented to the individual with the lowest average time. And I'll read the award. This award recognizes the achievements of an individual who had the lowest average time for all firefighter abilities test throughout the academy. The individual started the academy in superb shape and improved it upon the 21 weeks. To receive the Firefighter Abilities Test Award for your class is a great honor and says that you stepped up to the challenge. Far below the time required to complete the course, with an overall average time of 3 minutes and 2 seconds. On behalf of the training staff and your fellow classmates, we'd like to congratulate you for your level of achievement over the past 21 weeks of training. Your achievements have earned you the 66th Recruit Class Firefighters Abilities Test Award. We'd like to call up Firefighter Chris Braddock.
Come on back up here, Mr. Holmes.
Let's say good morning to good morning, everyone. Just thankful to be able to come up and present on behalf of the class. Somebody said that it couldn't be done, but he with a chuckle replied that maybe it couldn't, but he would be one who wouldn't say so till he tried. So he buckled right in with a trace of a grin on his face. If he worried he'd hit it, he started to sing as he tackled a thing that couldn't be done, and he did it. Somebody scoffed, "Oh, you'll never do that. At least no one has ever done it." But he took off his coat and he took off his hat, and the first thing we knew, he'd begun it. With a lift of his chin and a bit of a grin, without any doubting or quit it, he started to sing as he tackled the thing that couldn't be done, and he did it. Over the last few weeks, we've done some seemingly impossible tasks. We ate CS gas for lunch. We climbed tall buildings and punched holes in roofs. Through ventilation, we were able to give sight to the blind. Through CPR, we learned how to bring back the dead. Through salvage and overhaul, we redeemed what was lost. With discipline, we relaxed inside of tight, confined spaces. We crawled, we climbed, we grew, and now on this, our day of jubilee, we celebrate. Celebrate, celebrate. Graduation day, celebrate. We are excited, we are humbled, and we are resolved. Why are you so excited, you may ask, and I believe that Chief Crocker said it best inside of 1910 when he responded to accusations of desiring to leave the fire service to run for public office. He responded, "I have no ambition in the world but one, comma." And that is to be a fireman. The position may, in the eyes of some, appear to be a lowly one, but we who know the work which a fireman has to do believe that his is a noble calling. There is an adage which states that nothing can be destroyed in this world except by fire. We strive to preserve from destruction the wealth of the world, which is the product of the industry of men and necessary for the comfort of both the rich and the poor. We are the defenders from fire of the art which has beautified the world, and is a means of refinement for mankind. But above all, our proudest endeavor is to save the lives of men, which is the work of God himself. Under the impulse of such thoughts, the nobility of the occupation thrills us and stimulates us to deeds of daring, even at the supreme sacrifice. Such considerations may not strike the average mind, but they are sufficient to fill to the limit our ambition in life and to make us serve the general purpose of human society. We are excited because over the last few weeks, we've received some of the best training that this country has to offer. We are excited because we've learned how to use the tools that has been placed inside of our hands. You see, here's the thing. The right tools in the wrong hands are worthless, but the right tools in the right hands are priceless. You see, a tennis racket inside of my hands are worthless. But a tennis racket inside of the hands of Venus Williams will win you Wimbledon. A basketball inside of my hands is worth maybe about $19, but a basketball inside of the hands of Michael Jordan is worth over $19 billion. A golf club inside of my hands might give you a round of putt-putt. It might chip a ball into the woods, but a golf club inside of the hands of Tiger Woods or Rory McIlroy will win you the PGA tournament. A few months ago, a Halligan tool in my hand was absolutely worthless. A fire hose in my hand was nothing more than a high-pressure car wash, but now, I can open or break through an enclosure that cannot be opened by conventional means. I can take my fire hose, which, for those of you who don't know, is a type of flexible tools the firefighters use to carry water under pressure from the sources applied to a point where it is discharged, so I can stop, inhibit, or extinguish the self-sustaining process of rapid oxidation of a fuel being oxidized by being reduced by an oxidizing agent, along with the rapid rates of heat and light. In other words, I can break through a door and put water on the fire. And this excites us. But we're also humbled. We're humbled because of the fact that when the building is on fire, when the defecation has hit the oscillating device, someone is going to pick up the phone and dial 911, and perhaps they're going to send me. Perhaps they're going to send one of the class of 66. Someone with their lifeless child inside of their arms, someone with all of their belongings, literally up in flames, is going to look at me, look at us, and hand me their Rubik's Cube of a problem and say, fix it. Stop this terror and make me feel safe again. Save my life. Protect my property. Wow. What an honor. What an honor to be in the presence, in the service, in the brotherhood, in the fellowship, in the family of the men and women who are quietly going about the business of saving the people of this society from things that go bump in the night. We are humbled because we know that we are standing on the shoulders of smoke eating, fire walking, Halligan tool toting, up all day, calls all night, no sleeping, still performing, rough and tough fire dogs. We know that we have been standing on the shoulders of these giants, and shortly here, we will be called upon to work side by side and hand in hand with the proven rescue workers of this community, and this humbles us. We are also resolved. We are resolved to accept what's coming next. For some of us, that's a 6-month EMT course that will be crammed into a little bit more than 4 weeks. The rest of us are anxious to serve, anxious to be with our new brethren online, and we all know that there will be pain. We know that there is still much to learn. We know that we signed up to be servants, and sometimes servants aren't treated right. We know that we will fall. We know that we will come short. We know that there will be critics, but we still remain resolved. Theodore Roosevelt said, it is not the critic who counts. It's not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs and comes short again and again, because there is no effort without error and shortcoming, but who does actually strive to serve, to do the deeds, who knows the great enthusiasms, the great devotions, who spends himself inside of a worthy cause, who at best knows triumph and of high achievement, and who at worst, if he fails, at least he fails while daring greatly, so that his place will never be among those cold and timid souls who know neither victory nor defeat. Yes, we are excited. Yes, we are humbled. Yes, we will fall. And yes, there will be critics. And yes, we remain resolved. We remain resolved to push through these next challenges. We remain encouraged to push through the pain, not only because of the nobility of the occupation that thrills us, not only because of our desire to serve this city humbly, not only because of the tools that we've been given, we are encouraged because of you. You are the families that have gathered here today to witness your child, your husbands, your fathers, your brothers, your uncles' success. And we thank you for being the tools that God has used to encourage us when we wanted to give up. You listened to the stories that I'm sure didn't make complete sense. Don't try to figure it out. You learned more about fire behavior and hydraulics than I'm sure you ever desired, and you gave us a place to go, a safe place to go to have those conversations. Though I'm sure it can be said of many inside of this room, I'm only a witness to my wife's constant support and encouragement. So as we thank you all collectively, I thank her personally. Jeannie Johnson Holmes is my wife, and whom I am well pleased. We are encouraged by the firefighters who have gone on before us, who have fought fires with bare hands and blue jeans. We are encouraged by the leadership who month after month after month after month after month took the experiential wisdom that was given to you and poured it carefully into our hearts and minds until we brimmed with information. You guided our hands and taught us the craft that you taught us this craft, and you have given us something that can never be, that could be lost, but it can never be taken away, and we thank you. We thank you because you took the unnatural and made it second nature. You taught us a true natural walk. We are encouraged by our naysayer who smiled on us when we, who smiled whenever we stumbled and hoped that we fell. And we thank you because you gave us somebody to prove wrong. And finally, we thank God. He's the song in my heart. He's the pep in my step, the voice in my head. And I need no disrespect to anybody else who may believe differently, but to be consistent with my own faith, I thank God. As I take my seat and invite Chief Nix up, I leave you with this word of encouragement. There are thousands that will tell you it cannot be done, thousands that prophesy failure. There are thousands that point out to you one by one the dangers that wait to assail you. But just buckle it in with a trace of a grin. Just take off your coat and go to it. Just start to sing as you tackle the thing that cannot be done, and you'll do it. So on behalf of the class of 66, Terrence Blaylock, Chris Braddock, Wes Brain, Travis Carter, Zachary Coltrane, Marcus Cox, Josh Crump, Chad Deal, Rolando Evans, Derek Henley, Christopher Holmes, Larry Howard, Kyle Martin, Joseph Masburn, Jason Rook, Graydon Shaw, Dylan Whitmore, and Leroy Jenkins, we thank you for the work that you've done.
Tremendous. Tremendous. Thank you.
About ready to pass the plate. Okay. We are going to top that, though, because we're getting ready to pin the badges. Recruits, prepare yourselves to receive your badges. Line up. Family members, we will be in alphabetical order. Please line up over here. Terrence Blaylock, Jr., penned by Leah Blaylock. I know everyone is individually is special, but if we could hold all the applause until the very end, appreciate it. Chris Braddock. Penned by Erica Braddock. Wesley Brain, penned by David Brain. Travis Carter, penned by Jesse Walker. Zachary Coltrane, penned by Lindsay Coltrane. Marcus Cox, penned by Emily Cox. Joshua Crump, penned by Bridget Crump. Chad Deal, penned by Natalie Deal. Lando Evans, penned by Shanita Evans. Derek Henley, penned by Pat Henley. Christopher Holmes, penned by Jeannie Holmes. Larry Howard Jr., penned by Crystal Howard. Cal Martin, penned by Brooksy Martin. Joseph Mashburn, penned by Pam Mashburn. Jason Rook, penned by Carl Rook. Graydon Shaw, penned by Mildred Zafra. Dylan Whittemore, penned by Sarah Whittemore. You can clap. All right, recruits, prepare yourselves for the oath of office. Raise your right hand. I pronounce your name in full and repeat after me. Do solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution of the United States. So help me God. I do further solemnly and sincerely swear that I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to the state of North Carolina and to the constitutional powers and authorities which are or may be established for the government thereof, and that I will endeavor to support, maintain, and defend the Constitution of said state, not inconsistent with the Constitution of the United States, to the best of my knowledge and ability. So help me God. I do further swear that I will well and truly execute the duties as a Greensboro firefighter according to the best of my skill and ability and according to law. So help me God. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the newest members of the Greensboro Fire Department, the 66 recruit class. Captain Hall, dismiss the recruits.
66, attend hook. You're dismissed. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes our ceremony.
Thank you.